is March 20th, 2016. Today is Palm Sunday.
St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. This is the beginning of Holy Week, Palm Sunday, March the 20th, 2016. The hymn is All Glory, Lord, and Honor, written by Theophilus of Orleans, 760 to 822, ancient Lenten hymn.
Thank you. Please turn to page three in your worship. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Is reading the scripture today.
First reading for today is from the 15th chapter of Isaiah. The Lord God has given me the tongue of a teacher, that I may know how to sustain the weary of your word. Morning by morning he wakens, waken my ear to listen as those who are taught. The Lord God has opened my ear, and I was not rebellious. Did not turn backward. I gave my back to those who struck me, and my cheeks to those who pulled out the beard. I did not hide my face from insult and spitting. The Lord God helps me, therefore I have not been disgraced. Therefore I have set my face like flint, and I know that I shall not be put to shame. He who vindicates me is near. Who will contend with me? Let us stand together. Who are my adversaries? Let them comfort me. It is the Lord God who helps me, who will declare me guilty. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Becky Dimitrioff is doing a song.
Second reading for the today is from the second chapter of Philippians. Let the same mind be in you that was in Christ Jesus, who though he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God as something to be exploited, but emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, being born in human likeness, and being found in human form, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God highly exalted him and gave him the name that is above every name, so that in the name of Jesus every knee should bend, in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Singing the Lenten acclamation as our pastor John Pollock, is preparing to read the gospel. This is Palm Sunday, the beginning of Holy Week. We will celebrate Maundy Thursday, Good Friday, and Easter this week.
The Holy Gospel according to St. Luke, the 19th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. After he had said this, Jesus went on ahead, going up to Jerusalem. When he had come near Bethage and Bethany, at the place called the Mount of Olives, he sent two of his disciples, saying, "Go into the village ahead of you, and as you enter it, you will find tied there a colt that has never been ridden. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks you, 'Why are you untying it?' just say this, 'The Lord needs it.' So those who were sent departed and found it as he had told them. As they were untying the colt, its owner asked them, 'Why are you untying the colt?' They said, 'The Lord needs it.' Then they brought it to Jesus, and after throwing their cloaks on the colt, they set Jesus on it. As he rode along, people kept spreading their cloaks on the road. As he was now approaching the path down from the Mount of Olives, the whole multitude of the disciples began to praise God joyfully with a loud voice for all the deeds of power that they had seen, saying, 'Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord, peace in heaven and glory in the highest heaven.' Some of the Pharisees in the crowd said to him, 'Teacher, order your disciples to stop.' He answered, 'I tell you, if these were silent, the stones would shout out.'" The Gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
You may be seated. A couple of announcements to share with you quickly. First of all, of course, this being Palm Sunday means this is the beginning of Holy Week. On Maundy Thursday, we will have services at 2 and 7 p.m. here in the sanctuary. And then again on Good Friday, we will have services at 2 and 7 p.m. So I hope that you will observe both of those important days in the Passion of our Lord. And of course, it culminates with the celebration and of his resurrection on Easter Sunday. On Easter Sunday, we will have services at our regular time. Also, there will be an Easter breakfast in place of the Sunday school hour. And also, there will be an Easter egg hunt for the children. And there will be children's church at the 10:30 service. So I invite your nieces and nephews and grandchildren and children all to be here with us. Also, for those of you who read each week, and communion assistants, worship assistants, the new sign-up sheets for April, May, and I think the first part of June are on the front pews. You may sign up after the service is over. Remember, in June, on the last Sunday in May, we go out, the 8 o'clock service goes out to the drive-in, and some of you who read at 10:30 read at 8 at the drive-in during the summer, so be sure that for the last Sunday in May, Sunday in June, if you want to read, you should make sure which service it is. Ask now that you give your attention to our choir.
Thank you.
I invite you to take out those sermon notes that you have been given and to follow along. Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. As we begin this morning, let us go back to that 30th verse of that 19th chapter of the Gospel of St. Luke, where we read Jesus saying, "Go into the village in front of you, where on entering you will find a colt tied on which no one has ever yet sat. Untie it and bring it here." As you review those words, it's important to remember as we go along that this is a colt tied on which no one has ever yet sat. So that will be explained as we examine God's word this morning. So the question is, why did Jesus ride into Jerusalem on a donkey? Why did he not, in order to make a grand impression, ride into Jerusalem on a great war charger? Beautiful stallion, this black or white, chestnut color? Or why did he come in a chariot pulled by four horses, like we see in the movie Ben-Hur? Or why did he not come on a gilded throne, carried by litter bearers, as the people proclaimed Hosanna, "Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord"? Did he ride a donkey because it was convenient? Or did he ride a donkey because that was the only thing his friends could afford? Why a donkey? To understand why it is important for Jesus to ride a donkey, you must understand what the triumphal entry was all about. Jesus rides on a donkey into the city of Jerusalem to show to the crowds that first of all, he comes in peace. In the ancient world, unlike today, the donkey was a noble animal, where today we simply look at it as a beast of burden, we use it as a symbol for a political party, it's often used as a subject of jokes. In the ancient world, the donkey was considered so noble that if a king or queen or emperor or representative theirs was coming to a city in peace, they would ride a donkey. They would come on a donkey because that was the animal of peace. If they were coming to a city in order to invade it, to conquer it, or if it was a city that they already ruled and they were coming in because they were unhappy with it, or they were going to announce new taxes, or that they were going to start drafting more people for their military or whatever, then they would ride a charger, a steed, a chariot, or being carried on a throne by litter bearers. But a donkey meant peace. A donkey meant you had nothing to fear about the one who is riding upon the animal. And so Jesus had to come into the city of Jerusalem to show that he came in peace, and not as a conqueror, not as some type of military expert or military champion. Of course, it also fulfilled the prophecy of the prophet Zechariah, who in the 9th chapter of his book tells us that the Messiah is going to come, and that he will ride on the colt of a donkey, and that it will be one on which no one has ever sat. So Jesus is symbolizing his peaceful intentions. Jesus comes to bring peace to the people. Peace between God and us. Peace between one another. He did not enter Jerusalem to drive out the Romans, as many were hoping. Nor did he enter Jerusalem to drive out any other enemies of Israel. And he comes to you this Palm Sunday to give you this peace as well. Go back for a moment to the night of Jesus' betrayal, which we will celebrate, or not celebrate, but observe on Monday, Thursday. And remember how in that upper room, Jesus began begins by washing the disciples' feet, which surprised and shocked all of them. And then remember how he instituted the sacrament of the altar, the Lord's Supper, Holy Communion. And then, as recorded in the Gospel of John, he goes on to give them all types of instructions that they are to repeat and teach after he dies, resurrects, and ascends into heaven. And in that conversation, in the 16th chapter of John, in verse 33, he gives this promise. He says, "I have said these things to you, that in me you may have peace. In the world you will have tribulation, but take heart, I have overcome the world. I have said these things to you, that in me you may have peace." Now, peace means a lack of confusion, a lack of despondency, a lack of distress. As Jesus is using it here, it means to keep on having peace even after his death. In other words, it is that peace which passes all understanding that only Jesus can give us. And as he says, we're going to have tribulation. Jesus never promises us a rose garden. Jesus never promises us that by believing in him, by accepting his invitation of grace, that suddenly everything bad in our lives is going to become good, and that what is good is going to become even better. He never promises us a Cadillac in every garage and prime rib on every plate. He says to follow him, there will be tribulation. And that word tribulation means to undergo distress, to have opposition, to have affliction. The Greek word literally means, in its most pure form, to squeeze something or to crush it. If you're being squeezed by something or crushed, you're in tribulation, you're in distress, you have opposition, you're having affliction. But Jesus is saying he will give us this peace that will enable us to take heart, that is to have courage, to have confidence, because he has overcome the world. That word overcome means to prevail, to be victorious, or to conquer. Jesus has done all these things through his sacrificial death upon the cross, through his shedding his blood on our behalf, paying that debt of sin that we owe. He has done this by his resurrection and ascension, by his fulfilling his Father's will, fulfilling the plan of salvation to its fullest. That is why he could say on the cross, it is finished, it is completed, it is accomplished. And he gives to us this peace that nothing can take away from us. And that peace is victory over the unholy three: sin, death, and the power of the devil. With this knowledge that Jesus has conquered them, which with his peace that he gives us, we know that no matter what the world throws at us, no matter what the world dishes out at us, we can handle it by having that faith in Jesus Christ, because we know the end of the story. We know that the end is not this earthly life, that the end is not how many material things we have when we die, that the end is not just us going away into some dust, but that the end is eternity in the kingdom. This is what motivated St. Paul, the greatest missionary and theologian of the church, who was having this peace. And having this peace from Jesus, Paul was able to say in that letter to the Philippians, which we read already this morning, from chapter 2, let us go to chapter 4, where he says these words that are very familiar to most of us. Some of you probably have on a little plaque in your office, or hanging on the wall in your kitchen, or you know somebody that has it. Chapter 4, verse 13, St. Paul says, "I can do all things through him who strengthens me." I can do all things. I can face persecution. I can face shipwreck. I can face beatings. I can face imprisonment. I can face wrecks. I can face being let out of a basket of a wind and a bit. I can be strengthened in times of hunger. All because of this peace. That word strength means to make effective, to handle something, to empower something, or to enable them. So St. Paul is saying, I can be empowered in all situations. I can be enabled. I can be made effective. I can handle anything through the strength that comes to me through this peace that Jesus has won for me with his suffering death upon the cross. And so St. Peter did indeed face persecution, imprisonment, shipwrecks, beatings, and even death. But in all of it, he was filled with that peace that only Jesus can give. This peace which passes all understanding. This peace which nothing can separate us from. So this is the first reason why Jesus had to be on the donkey, to show that he came in peace. Secondly, Jesus enters Jerusalem on a donkey to show that he is coming to serve. As Jesus told his disciples more than once, the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve. To come as a servant for all. A donkey serves people. A donkey carries people's burdens and makes life easier for them. Likewise, Jesus came to serve and to carry the burdens of people. As the world places burdens on the donkey, Jesus says, come and place your burdens on me. Come and put your difficulties on me. Come and bring those things that weigh you down and give them to me. Yet today, many a good Christian is failing to place their burdens on Jesus. Instead, they believe that they can do it themselves. They can handle it themselves. They'll figure it out themselves. And so by trying to do it all themselves, all they do is become stressed out, depressed, despondent, and feel like a failure. As Jesus enters Jerusalem that first Palm Sunday on that donkey, he was saying, I am here to serve you. I am here to take your burdens upon myself, give them to you. People still refuse to do so. They refuse to accept or to listen to Jesus' invitation, which he offers us in the 11th chapter of Matthew, when he says, come unto me, all ye who are burdened and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Jesus rides that donkey to assure you that he has come to serve, to take your sins upon himself, to take your burdens upon himself, to take the weight of guilt upon himself, to take whatever might burden you down, to take it upon himself, to have it nailed to the cross with him, and to offer his blood to pay for it so that you might have that peace at all times, and that you might have him as your servant. That brings us to the third reason. And this is where verse 30 comes in, about a colt that on which no one had ever sat. The third reason it was necessary for Jesus to come into Jerusalem on a donkey instead of in a chariot or in a throne carried by litter bearers or on a stallion or war steed, he had to come in order to show that his mission was sacred and not secular. Had he come in any of those other ways I mentioned, people would have thought his mission was secular. That he was coming as that secular Messiah. By the time of Jesus, people had chafed under the oppression of Rome for so long that their thoughts had become clouded as to what Scripture really said about the Messiah. And instead of a sacred Messiah, they were looking for a secular Messiah. But that is not why Jesus came. The colt on which Jesus rode had never been ridden before, and this was important because, as we see under Old Testament law, any animal used for the sacred or used for sacrificial use had to be perfect, had to be without spot or blemish, and it could never have been used for any kind of secular use. So Jesus rides upon a colt which had never been used to emphasize the sacred and spiritual nature of his mission. He emphasizes the fact that he is fulfilling the plan of God, not the plan of human beings. Unfortunately, the people did not want to listen. For as we know all far too well, that those cries of Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord on this Palm Sunday, by Friday had turned into the shouts of crucify, crucify, because the people wanted the secular and not the sacred. But Jesus emphasizes the fact that the sacred is what brings true life. That the Messiah was not the secular warrior to drive out the Romans, but that the Messiah is the sacred Messiah, the suffering servant of Isaiah, the suffering servant of other Old Testament prophets, the suffering servant of Psalms, the law, and the other writings of Scripture. He is the Messiah of God, the Savior of the world. Jesus comes riding on that donkey to emphasize the importance of the sacred over the secular, the importance of the sacred life over the frills of society that moth and rust destroy and thieves break in and steal. Life is not found in how many toys you have when you die. Life is not found in how much property you own when your life is ended. True life is found in the secret. The secular world would have you believe that these material things are important, as they bombard you every day with all types of advertising as to what you should buy, as far as everything from shampoo to deodorant, to cologne, to the car you drive, to the plates you use, the paper products you buy, the places you go for vacation, and any other thing in life. But they're just free. They're just temporary. True life is found in the sacred. True life is found in the sacredness of a personal relationship with God through faith in Jesus Christ. So Jesus shows you by riding this colt on which no one had ever ridden before that he comes, and these are the answers to question 8. So be ready. He comes to save humanity, not destroy it. He demonstrates that God is a God of love and reconciliation, not a God of wrath and destruction. That is what life is all about. That Jesus came not to destroy humanity, but to serve, save humanity, to demonstrate that God is a God of love and reconciliation, not a God of wrath and destruction. So why a donkey on that first Palm Sunday? Why not a stallion? Why not a chariot? Why not a majestic throne carried by litter bearers? Because Jesus had to show that he comes in peace and that he brings peace to you. A peace between you and God and a peace between you and others. He had to show that he comes to serve all of humanity. And that he comes to serve you as well. And that he invites you to give him your burdens. To give him the weight of guilt. To give you that guilt of sin. To give him anything that is a burden. That is why he has come. He rode that donkey in order to show you that his mission was sacred and not secular. And that it is the sacred and not the secular that true life is found. That is why a donkey was needed. So thank God for the donkey. Thank God for the peace. Thank God for the service. And thank God for the sacred. Amen. The peace of God which passes all understanding. Keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus.
Those who can, please rise. He came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake he was crucified and washed his body. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and Son, who with the Father and Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the cross. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
As we celebrate Jesus' entry into Jerusalem, let us pray for all those he came to save. Our response today is, hear our prayer. Heavenly Father, we praise you for your entry into the world through your Son, Jesus. Join our voices in praise, and every time we shout, Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Be present with the nations of the world, that those who lead and those who lead them. May every leader seek the same of yours and of Jesus Christ, working to fulfill your holy will. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. Unite our voices, that we would may hear it clearly, especially in Holy Week, in love of God in Christ crucified and risen for us, for our salvation. May every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of the Father. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Join our voices with the plea of Christ to forgive. Transform our hearts and minds for forgiveness. Forgive those who have sinned against you, us, as well as forgive ourselves. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We forgive those who prepare the ground, tilling and the soil, sowing the seeds. Provide favorable weather that the land may yield enough food for all the people to be satisfied. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for the sick and injured. Restore them to well-being. Be present for the caregivers, that they may find support for their vocations, even as they care for loved ones. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
As the shadow lengthens and the evening falls upon those who near death, as well as those who are keeping vigil for all who mourn, may they draw comfort in the resurrection of Christ our Lord. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
That into your hands we command all to whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
Amen.
You may be seated.
Time for our offering. Nelson and Linda Smith are the ushers. The offering is being received. The pastor is preparing the elements of Holy Communion. Body and blood of Jesus Christ, the bread and the wine. Flowers on the chancel stand today are given to the glory of God, presented by Pam Riggs to the glory of God, and the family of Anna Bechtel in honor of her 94th birthday. And the flowers are also given by Becky Dimitrov in memory of Russ and Dolores Mittman's 65th wedding anniversary. You can see the palms, beautiful decorations in front of our altar. See the parament with the crown of thorns. All these are aids to worship. As we understand, during Holy Week, Jesus Christ died for us. We've confessed, we've repented, we love God, we love our neighbors. We're being fulfilled, we're being filled with the Holy Spirit. We'll go out and serve others. Thanks be to God, Jesus died for us. Save us from sin, give us eternal life, so we can all be together. Thank you. We invite you to come worship with us during Holy Week on Thursday, Maundy Thursday, 2 o'clock, 7 o'clock in our sanctuary. Good Friday, 2 o'clock and 7 o'clock. Then on Easter Sunday, we have an Easter breakfast at 9. Then the Easter service is at 10:30, which we will celebrate the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. Our ushers are now bringing the offering forward.
Let us pray. Holy God, gracious and merciful, you bring forth food from the earth and nourish your whole creation. Turn our hearts to those who hunger in any way, that all may know your care and prepare us now to the feast on the bread of life. Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
St. John practices an open communion. For all those who are baptized and believe in Jesus Christ as a personal Lord and Savior, who believe his body and blood are truly present as we gather at this table in our communion age in our own individual congregation, we invite and encourage you to come forward with us this day as we gather at the table of the Lord. I again invite those who can without difficulty to please stand as we continue our celebration with the spoken great thanksgiving on page 6 in your worship book. Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
Holy God, mighty Lord, gracious Father, endless is your mercy and eternal your reign. You have filled all creation with light and life. Heaven and earth are full of your glory. We praise you for the grace shown to your people in every age, the promise to Israel, the rescue from Egypt, the gift of the promised land, the words of the prophets, and at this end of all the ages, the gift of your Son who proclaimed the good news in word and deed, and was obedient to your will, even to giving his life. In the night which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is a new covenant in my bloodshed, given for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." For as often as we eat of this bread and drink from this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
Therefore, O God, with this bread and cup, we remember the life our Lord offered for us. And believing the witness of his resurrection, we await his coming in power to share with us the great and promised feast. Amen. Come, Lord Jesus. So now we pray your Holy Spirit, that we who share in Christ's body and blood may live to the praise of your glory and receive our inheritance with all your saints and life.
Amen. Come, Holy Spirit.
Join our prayers with those of your servants of every time and every place, and unite them in the ceaseless petitions of our great high priest until he comes as victorious Lord of all. Through him, with him, in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, our glory and honors is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us.
Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
given for you. Body of Christ given for you.
Right.
The body of Christ given for you. Body of Christ given for you. Body of Christ. Body of Christ given for you. Body of Christ. Body of Christ given for you. Body of Christ given for you. Body of Christ given for you. The 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 body of Christ given for you. Body of Christ given for you. Body of Christ given. Body of Christ given for you. 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 Blood of Christ shed.
Body of the Lord Jesus Christ, whose precious blood strengthen and preserve you in true faith, on the life eternal. Amen.
Let us pray. God of abundance, with this bread of life and cup of salvation, you have united us with Christ, making us one with all your people. Now send us forth into the power of your Spirit, that we may proclaim your redeeming love to the world and continue forever in the risen life of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Amen.
Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever.
Amen. Amen.
We conclude our celebration with I Believe in a Hill Called Mount Calvary, the hymn that is inserted in your book. I Believe in a Hill Called Mount Calvary, the inserted hymn.
Our final hymn is a gospel hymn written by an American group, the Gaithers, William J. Gaither. I Believe in a Hill Called Mount Calvary. We're singing this for Holy Week as we're meditating on Jesus' death on Calvary. We are celebrating now the triumphal entry And this week we'll celebrate Holy Week. And this final hymn is I Believe in a Hill, called Mount Calvary, written by William Gaither, Bill Gaither Trio. Offers a Christian school program for ages 3 and 4, nursery and pre-K. For more information, you may call the school office, 325-4311. That's 325-4311. We'd like for you to come join us anytime. We'd like for you to enroll your children in our Christian school. We want you to be with us to celebrate Holy Week as we're now going forth to serve God and others to spread the gospel of Jesus Christ, that he died to save us from sin, provide us with eternal life, make us all one, to love one another, fill the world with his love. He came on earth to give love, to give salvation. We're thankful for that. I hope and I pray that God will continue to bless you this day and all your days. We will pray for you. Continue to pray for us. This is March the 20th, 2016, St. John's Lutheran Church, corner of Wittenberg in Columbia. We invite you to worship with us anytime. Continue to pray every day. We'll commune with God, the creator of the universe. He's created us and we're thankful for it. We go out now and we serve others. We're filled with the love of Christ. We'll spread it to others.